Hi everybody, it's Cindy from Ask Nurse Cindy, and today we are going to talk about a fatty liver. What is a fatty liver? Why is it becoming an epidemic problem? What can we do about it? What type of problems does it cause us? And can you eat keto while you're if you've been told that you have a fatty liver? So this is going to be a little video for a good portion of it. I'm going to be showing you a PowerPoint that I have used to educate on the fatty liver before, and so I hope you enjoy it. I'll try to flip back and forth a little bit, and hi Heather, hi Dr. Heather, how are you? And if you've ever shared one of my videos, this would be one of those just for your own reference, especially if you're listening and you can't really look at the pictures. I'd like to really break this down. This is a basic 101 on fatty liver, so it won't be all inclusive, but I think it'll really help you if you've been told you have one, if you know someone has it, or if you're just struggling with understanding if weight loss is slow, why do I even bother on keto? Because keto or low carb eating helps in so many ways. So let's get into it. I'll flip the, and I'm still in Hawaii and it's freezing cold. It's like 60. That's why I have a jacket on. So let's talk about NAFLD, N-A-F-L-D, which is non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. And this is a problem. It is becoming really epidemic in proportion. It used to be years ago that when we had someone that had liver disease, hi Lauren, how's my daughter? Hi sweetie pea. Are we at risk though today? If we're not a drinker, if we just drink a little bit, are we at risk to developing fatty liver? Because it used to be years ago, it was only diagnosed in those people that drank a lot because the liver has to metabolize alcohol. So let's look a little bit of what's going on here. Look at this ratio, and they're estimating that this is low. 25% of Americans have non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. So if there's four of you in your family, one out of those four, statistically speaking, already have it. A couple of others, maybe one other has it or the beginnings of it and doesn't even know. Look at that, one out of 10 children already have it. If you look at the obesity rate in our children, one out of 10 already have that. And please share this, this is an important video. And this is what's really one of the scariest things. Hi Steve, my brother Steve, who's a nurse as well. Non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, I'm gonna try to not move the phone around so much, hold on, let me see if I can prop it up, is often asymptomatic. Asymptomatic means without symptoms. If I'm afebrile, I don't have a fever. If I'm asymptomatic, I don't have symptoms. In other words, you can have non-alcoholic fatty liver disease or NAFLD and not even know it. And you'll only find it if a blood test reveals elevated liver enzymes. Maybe you've had an ultrasound for some other abdominal discomfort and they find it. Now, obesity, being overweight, is the leading risk factor for non-alcoholic fatty liver, or just fatty liver, with type 2 diabetes and abnormal blood lipids, meaning your cholesterol, your HDL, your LDL, and things like that. So be aware that it is, if you are overweight, if you have type 2 diabetes and you're overweight, there's a high likelihood that you yourself have some level of fatty liver disease. I'm not saying this to scare you. I'm saying this to have you increase the awareness of the importance of following a ketogenic lifestyle. It can progress to a more serious form called NASH, and that's non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, and that's marked by actual inflammation of the liver. Up to 25% of the people with NASH, which is the steatic hepatitis, the more severe form of this, will develop cirrhosis of the liver. Some will require a liver transplant. I don't know how true this is, but I heard a while back that cirrhosis caused by non-alcoholic fatty liver disease is one of the leading causes of liver transplant these days. So that's some interesting things. So let's talk a little bit about the liver. The liver is actually the heaviest organ that we have in our body, weighs about 3 pounds. It is right under your right rib cage, and it crosses over almost your right entire upper quadrant, And tucked below it is the gallbladder. A lot of you ask if you can do keto if you don't have a gallbladder. I haven't had a gallbladder for 25 years. A gallbladder is just a storage, a reservoir for bile, and bile is created in the liver, and bile is there's bile salts, there's some toxins in there, but there's basically, it is what helps you digest fat. So without it, a gallbladder, it doesn't mean you're not producing bile, it just means it's a drippy faucet going into your intestines all the time versus a reservoir that can squirt out the bile after a large fatty meal. So the liver is a large organ, about 3 pounds, and it has a lot of functions. This is just the bare bones minimum of what it does. Let's talk about detoxification. It is actually an amazing filter. It's a real filter, and it eliminates many toxins. It will shunt some toxins into the gallbladder and the bile, some into the kidneys, which will be excreted, and believe it or not, quite a few toxins are excreted through our stool, so it'll move that into the stool. And it also helps remove ammonia, our own waste products, from our cellular metabolism. And guys, so many of you ask, can I have alcohol on keto? It doesn't have many carbs, hard liquor, dry red wine. Oh, of course you can have it if you choose to, but be aware that it must be metabolized in the liver, and people die of alcohol toxicity, unfortunately, way too often, especially the young, when they go away to college and they get into these drinking games and they drink too much. The liver cannot process it. Toxins build up and they die, unfortunately. So it is definitely our major detoxification system for many things. Synthesis, in other words, it creates things, it synthesizes, it regulates the metabolism of carbohydrates, fats, and proteins. It helps produce the bile we talked about, and very, very importantly, assists in the coagulation process. It also synthesizes and creates cholesterol. Huh, I thought I was supposed to be afraid of cholesterol. No, cholesterol is very, very important for every cellular process and cellular structure. And it also is a great storage unit. So if you've ever rented a storage unit, you know you put things there that you don't want to get rid of, but you might need later. So it helps store vitamins A, D, and E, and glycogen, which is our ready supply of glucose. So it stores that. Liver's very, very important. Now, the whole concept of this is to give you a basic understanding of fatty liver. So what are the risk factors? Well, and this is really interesting because it's the yin and the yang. It's a vicious circle. One creates the other, which came first, the chicken and the egg. High cholesterol, high levels of triglycerides, which is the fat floating around in the blood. Metabolic syndrome, which is pre-diabetes. Type 2 diabetes, obesity, especially if you carry it in the abdomen. If you carry a lot of your fat in your viscera, in your abdomen versus in your legs and your butt and your hips, you are more likely to have fatty liver disease. And women with PCOS are more prone to it. If you have low thyroid, hypothyroid, and if you suffer with sleep apnea, all of those are risk factors that might predispose you to having it even if you don't know it. Now, the liver has two lobes, the right and the left. Within that, there are lobules, which are smaller sections, and it breaks down to the basic hepatocyte. HEPA, liver, hepatitis, inflammation or infection of hepatocytes, liver cells. So that's how that all breaks down, those words. So our liver does have fat in it. It is going to always have some fat as storage, but if it's greater than 5 to 10% of the weight of it, if when they do an ultrasound or if they do liver enzymes and your liver's all out of whack, they'll probably then do an ultrasound if they've not already, and they're going to evaluate how much fat is in your liver. Just like fat on my hips takes up more space and my hips get wider, fat accumulating inside your liver is going to actually cause the liver to grow and get bigger. So this is a fatty liver. I have greater than 10% fat in my liver. And if that is not resolved, if I do not change my lifestyle and help my body not store fat here, then it is going to progress to what they call NASH, which is the non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. And so this is fat plus now it's been there so long and it's taking up so much space that it's pushing out my functioning hepatocytes and it's causing not only inflammation, but I'm now getting scarring. So instead of a fully functioning liver, I have a liver that's really starting to not work well. And then the next step, which we really don't, none of us want this to get to this point, is cirrhosis. And this is where the scar tissue literally replaces so much of the liver cells, you might start to see yellow in the whites of your eyes called jaundice, or yellow on your palms. Your urine might become pumpkin orange. Hopefully it's been diagnosed way before this if you have it, but that's the spectrum and the progression, which we don't need to follow. Hi, Chris Lessing. Oh my gosh, that's so funny. Good to see you guys. So what is it? It used to be, as I mentioned earlier, associated mainly with alcoholism. Now it's hugely apparent in non-alcoholics. So NAFLD, NAFLD is the non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. and the NASH is non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. So already mentioned that. Now, I'm not going to look at this a lot, but I want you just to see it, this schematic. So if your BMI, your basal metabolic, body mass index, basal metabolic rate, your body mass index is less than 25, you might have a few fat droplets here and there. If your BMI is between 25 and 30, there's a very high likelihood that a lot of the fat that's in your rest of your body is now also being stored in your liver, and your fat cells are getting, your cells are getting bloated, the nucleus is off center, and you have bigger fat droplets. If your BMI is or was higher, we're looking at 30 to 35, then we're starting to get more damage, more malfunctioning of our nuclei, the sort of a factory of that, and we start to have more and more problems. And anyone that's greater than a 35 BMI, you have not, this isn't a guarantee, but you have a higher likelihood that there's these types of problems. So if I were to look at it under a microscope, not that most of you are clinicians, normal liver tissue under a microscope has this nice sort of even look. I do see some fat. You are going to have some fat in every liver, but fatty liver disease, you can literally see, this is the non-alcoholic type, you can literally see how large those fat globules are, and it really literally is going to mess with the functioning of your hepatocytes and your liver function, and then when you get into the NASH. And so this drawing is showing, this schematic, this artist rendition is showing a normal liver being 3 pounds. Look at how much bigger this liver is with the fatty liver. And so that's where a lot of people will get a lot of shortness of breath. They won't feel as well. They'll be very fatigued because they're not cleaning out their blood supply. The filter isn't working as well because things are not working. So what's the difference between NAFLD and NASH? Because one's worse than the other, of course. Greater than 30% of the adults today and around 13% of the children, according to this reference, have it. Is it reversible? I want you to look at that. Yes, yes. And there's minimal reduction in liver function. So if you've been told you have fatty liver, you definitely need to drop your carbs. And we'll talk about that in just a minute. If you're told you have NASH, this is the further progression of that. NASH is in a smaller percent, and it's in 15 to 20% of obese adults. It is reversible still in the early stages. The liver is an amazing organ. Let me turn around for a minute. The liver is an amazing organ, and it has an amazing ability to regenerate itself. It really does. So if you've been told you have fatty liver, I don't want you to be depressed. I don't want you to say, oh my God, this, my life is over. It's not. Your life's just beginning if you understand what gave you fatty liver and you can address those changes. So let's go back to the slides here for a minute. It is reversible. Even the NASH is reversible in the early stages, but you are going to have some damage to your liver function and your liver cells are going to be injured, and it will become cirrhosis if it isn't dealt with. So please, if you do drink, don't drink more than 2 drinks a day, and consider not drinking every day. It is really, if you think you have fatty liver, or you've been told you have fatty liver, and you're insulting your liver with alcohol, you are really, you're headed for trouble. So please consider that as something that you don't want to do. I liked this drawing because it shows what a normal liver would look like, what a fatty liver would look like, how it starts to get this cirrhotic sort of scarring here when it's NASH, and then when it gets into cirrhosis, this is where you're really going to have lifetime and irreversible issues in many ways. So what might be causing this? Oh, let me zoom in. Current research is implicating excessive carbohydrate intake, especially fructose. We know that glucose, blood sugar, is an elevation after I eat a carbohydrate, but fructose, which is fruit sugar, and all table sugar is 1/2 glucose or sucrose and 1/2 fructose, is going, all of it must be metabolized in the liver and only in the liver. Let me say that again. Those orange juices you've been drinking, the fruit smoothies, fruit this, fruit that, fruit's good for me, fruit's good for me. Every time I eat fruit, I force my liver to metabolize it. So in other words, if I ate 120 calories of glucose, let's say I had a piece of bread, that was 120 calories of glucose, no sugar added. 1 calorie of that is going to be converted to fat. But since the liver's a big fat producing organ, if I ate 120 calories of orange juice or drank that, 40 calories of that would be converted to fat. And if you don't believe me, listen to Dr. Jason Fung and how he talks about a calorie is not a calorie. A calorie is absolutely going to stimulate different hormonal responses and trigger different things. So when we look at glucose, which is processed into energy, or it's stored as glycogen in the liver, muscles, or in our fat cells, and then when we look at fructose is directly metabolized into fat in the liver and then sent out, and oftentimes it's stored in the viscera as abdominal fat. Let me get back over here, I'm sorry. And it's also going to be stored inside of the liver itself, thus leading to fatty liver. So if you did nothing but stopped drinking fruit juices every day, all day, thinking you have to have that big 8-ounce glass of orange juice for breakfast, you would go a long way towards helping and drop your processed sugars, because sugar, let me turn it around, you look in my eyes. When I eat table sugar, when I eat that donut or that whatever it is, that whatever it is that has something made with sugar, that cookie, that muffin, half of those table sugar, when I take a teaspoon of it, half of that's going to be sucrose, which is metabolized into glucose, and half of that is fructose, which stays as fructose, and the liver has to deal with that. So just simply dropping, and that's why Robert Lustig out from San Francisco says, even if you just dropped your drink, your sugary drinks and your processed sugars, and you kept eating your bagels and wheat products, you would do a lot towards helping your fatty liver. So it's just really, really, really scary what fructose does to our body. So there's a very different metabolism in glucose versus fructose. So 100% of the burden rests on the liver, which is why if you've been told you have fatty liver, avoid fruits and fruit juices. Glucose metabolism is about 20% in the liver. The rest of it is processed via insulin when the glucose is absorbed into our bloodstream. Every cell in our body can utilize glucose. So, you know, so we have a lot available after meal, but your fructose is turned into free fatty acids, VLDL, and triglycerides, and those get stored as fat much more readily. Fructose is people who consume fructose in enormous quantities have these profound negative effects. So, where is it found? I've already talked about this a bit. Fruit juices, fruit smoothies, table sugars, it's half glucose and half sucrose, half glucose, half fructose, honey, agave nectar, coconut sugar, raw sugar, organic sugar, doesn't matter what sugar it is, it doesn't matter what plant it comes from, and especially we want to try to avoid the high fructose corn syrup that's in our sugary drinks, our sports drinks, etc., etc. Now, dietdoctor.com is one of my favorite places to send people. It's very evidence-based, very scientific. It does not take ads. They do not sell any products. Vast majority of their stuff is for free, and they have a groundbreaking study there that shows that low carb is an effective treatment for fatty liver. There are no medications that are there to dissolve the fat in the liver. The only thing that they talk about is losing weight, managing your diabetes, and to me, the best way to do that is via changing what you eat. So that's it for me on, let me see if I can flip, I did this something wrong here. How did I flip it? How do I flip it back around? You see, I'm still in Maui. So that's Fatty Liver 101. It's a real basic look. I'll be happy to do a deeper dive if those of you, some of you are interested in that. Let me see if I can grab my glasses. Please share this if you've not. I know it was sort of dry and boring. It was very medical based, but for those of you that are interested in that, are on that, it is reversible. Yes, so Lisa says she's reversed her fatty liver. Yes, so you can get off so many meds and reverse it. Basically, Jill, don't feel overwhelming. It is basically you go to eating whole foods. You go to eating vegetables grown above the ground. You eat your good, satisfying fats, your good, healthy fats, and you eat good meats. You avoid the processed crap that comes in cellophane. And it is amazing. First couple of days can be a little testy. I don't know about you guys. But if you read through, any of you that are feeling overwhelmed or you're wanting to know, you're feeling somebody shared this, scroll back through all these comments and look, there's a lot of comments here. So yes, you can. Can fatty liver cause me not to be able to handle fatty foods? I feel so nauseous. Erica, that's more likely if you still have your gallbladder that you have gallstones. And when you eat those fatty foods, the gallbladder contracts and it tries to squirt bile into your intestines because it's like Dawn dishwashing liquid. It helps dissolve the fat. But if it can't get out, if there's an obstruction, if you have a lot of even a little sludge in your gallbladder, it can cause you to feel nauseated and not feel good. So more likely that if you still have your gallbladder, but always, of course, please check with your doctor. This is just for general information. I'm not here to diagnose, treat, or cure. Yes, if you're overweight, Loretta, without diabetes, yes, you can certainly be still have fatty liver. And hi, Nancy, how are you? Good to see you. Yes, so sad about children having fatty liver. I'm sorry the broadcast keeps interrupting. I am coming from Hawaii, so I apologize for that. And we got hi, Karen from Cambodia. My goodness, that is amazing. So I think that's probably, let me see. Yep. Oh, you're so kind. Thanks, Sandra Fisher. So that's really kind of you guys. But that's it for me. Keto 101, fatty liver 101. So here's my interpretation of the literature and what I've been reading about and learning about when I go to these different conferences. Fatty liver has no medication to treat it. Fatty liver is rampant. So is our consumption of fructose and processed sweets. When we alter what goes in our mouth, we allow our body to take fat that we've stored, even in places we don't want it. And I'm not talking about how you look. I'm talking about the major organ of your liver, how it functions. And so when you decrease taking in those things, then the liver has the opportunity to burn that fat that's inside of it. It has the opportunity to cleanse itself, to get those fat globules out. And so much of the liver function can be regenerated. So I'm not here to give you medical advice, but I'm here to share with you my understanding of how a lower carbohydrate ketogenic eating plan can really impact your health. So I hope that makes sense. And if you'd like to share this with your friends, it would be great. I appreciate it. You guys have a great one. Talk to you soon. Bye.